Welcome back to another episode of Investing Explained. Here's today's question. Great question, and very timely now that we're doing an episode about value investing at Berkshire Hathaway. We actually have covered your question a few times before here on the show about how to value a company with no earnings. Or should I say, we talked about it, but not really explained how to do it, primarily because we don't know. As value investors, we discount the future expected cash flows, and if we don't have any, or if we can't make meaningful predictions, we really can't use our normal valuation approach. Now, the reason why I still wanted to play your question is because we as investors should not only ask what is the approach or the equation to how to value a profitable business versus how to value an unprofitable business. These are questions that Buffett has been asked multiple times before, so I actually took the liberty to tweak your question just a little into something I think would be more interesting, perhaps a bit more relevant for all of us. Rather, I would like to discuss something I hardly see covered, namely what is in between. So please allow me to elaborate. So everyone basically knows how much profit any public company is producing. You know, it's all in the financial statements. Successful investors are better at predicting how much money the company will make in the future. After all, it's the future and cash flows you've been entitled to as an investor. Now, as a value investor, you're looking for a company that already has a proven track record of being very good at making money and can be expected to make more money. Munger talked about this during the annual shareholders meeting. He was not unhappy about not spawning Amazon because that was not within historical competence. And as you mentioned, Kyle, it has not until recently made money. Rather, Munger is kicking himself for not investing in Google. So let's take Google as an example. You might for good reason say that so much has been said about Google and it's hard to find any future cash flows that the market has not accounted for. But I think Google serves as a great example, not just because Munger mentioned it, but really as an understanding of the current cash flows and projecting future cash flows. As you might know, the vast majority of Google's revenue will come from digital advertising, actually as much as 85%, and this is primarily through AdWords and AdSense. The industry grew as much as 21% last year, with Facebook and Google capturing the lion's share, and also you have Amazon coming into this market now, speaking of which. Now, conventional valuation metric would allow for you to determine how much you think the industry will grow, and how much of that growth Google will capture, and you can fairly easily come up with an intrinsic value. That is definitely a vital part of the equation. And then you have to figure out if you think that Google currently trading at a little more than 21 times enterprise value to earnings before interest and tax is high for a company with those growth prospects. It's really up to you. But where it really starts to become interesting, Kyle, is what you refer to with Amazon, the short-term pain for the long-term profitability. For Google, you should pay attention to the division they refer to as other bets. At first glance, it's nothing to be impressed about. You know, in the fourth quarter in 2018, for example, these other bets lost $1.3 billion, and this was in revenue on only $154 million. But still, there is a good reason why you should pay attention, because in other bets, you have Google's long-term investment. You have multiple companies, including Caligo, very interesting company that is combating aging-associated diseases. You have DeepMind, the British AI company founded by Dimitris Hassabis, which is perhaps the most famous AI company in the world, and has shown very promising results so far. And perhaps even more famous, you have Waymo, Google's self-driving car project, and by most experts said to be the most developed self-driving project on the planet. So Kyle, instead of thinking in terms of how do I value unprofitable companies and how to value profitable companies respectively, I would rather refer to what famous value investor Sanjay Baxi calls emerging moat. And that was something he talked about whenever we had him here on the show. So what he would do is he would focus on companies, and it could be companies like Google, so really good companies. And if you think the trade and the good valuation to ensure that you have a decent margin of safety, then you should really scrutinize the existing business model and also the projects that the company has in their pipeline when making your valuation. And by doing so, you also ensure that you have a sizable upside. So Kyle, Fantastic question. I'll also make sure to link to the pitch that we have here on the Mastermind Group in Q2 2018, where we specifically talked about Google if you're more interested in that company, but also to our interview with Sanjay Bakshi. The concept of emerging moat, that's definitely something that is often overlooked, even in the value investing community.
I don't have too much more to add other than what Stig said there. My only addition would be, personally, I look a lot at the top line, especially now, because I think you're seeing extremely large companies, call it Google, call it Amazon, that when you go back to the early days, the Benjamin Graham time frame, and he's talking about growth companies versus value companies, back then you didn't have companies that were the largest market cap businesses on the planet in a growth phase of their life cycle. At that size, they weren't growing at the speed that we see today. And so my argument for, let me just use a company that's out there right now, Tencent, huge company, massive multi-billion dollar size company. And yet you look at their top line and the rate at which that company's growing, and it's growing like crazy. And that's not something that you saw 50, 60 years ago, is a growth rate on a company of such that size. So what I would tell you, for me personally, I am very scared of investing in a growth company that's very small, that I don't really understand at an intimate level. So publicly traded business that's out there, that's small cap, I don't know it like I know my own business or something that you might own operationally. So that's why I say I'm a little scared of owning something like that, because the top line revenues or sales could be dependent on one critical thing that then just poof, it's gone in the next quarter. And then there goes your investment. There goes the share price, because it's so heavily reliant on that top line. But when you're dealing with a large cap company, I would argue the disappearance of that revenue or that top line is so much more difficult for it to just disappear, because you're dealing with so many assets on that balance sheet that are driving that top line. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, I'm more comfortable if it's a large cap company. I'm personally looking at the revenue growth, and I'm looking at the rate of that revenue growth, and I'm tracking the change in that rate. For me, is I'm looking at potentially investing in a quote unquote growth like company. So that's the only thing I want to add to what Stig said. And I think some of his points are just right on target, super important for people to understand. But this would be the only thing that I would add in addition to that.
That's it. Preston and I will continue explaining investing. So go ahead and hit that subscribe button.